Well, thank you very much for that delightful introduction. Thank you for having me. It's particularly nice that you have me, given that this talk, I'm going to talk about my own programming language, Idris. So it's particularly nice that you're having me because I'm not going to talk about Haskell. Idris is not Haskell. It is implemented in Haskell, and it looks a little bit like Haskell, so I hope that I'm not, you know, too much of an imposter. So you will recognize bits of it. But before I get to the language itself and start talking about, you know, how to use it, what it's for, I thought I might motivate it a little bit. I guess you've all seen one of these before. This is a computer monitor with, I don't know if you can read what's going on here. Anyone here do Java development as a day job? Yeah, I thought there might be quite a few. Do you often see traces like this? Yeah. So I saw this. The only unfortunate thing about this is that it's the train departure information at Crewe Railway Station, and this is not the sort of thing you typically want to see when you're trying to work out which train to get. So in this sort of situation, I imagine what they did is they just turned it off and on again. So this sort of thing, on the other hand, if anyone do rocket science as a day job? No, well, okay, there might have been, you never know, we're in a university. I took the last picture, I didn't take this picture. This is the Mars Climate Orbiter. Does anyone know the story of the Mars Climate Orbiter? It was sent to Mars in the late 1990s. The intention was to be a relay for the Mars Polar Lander, if I remember rightly. And what it actually did when it got to Mars was crash straight into it. And the reason it crashed into it was eventually traced to some ground-based software that had a discrepancy between imperial units and metric units. So this is my favorite ever type error, because everyone has a favorite type error, don't they? I think NASA are a bit more careful about this sort of thing these days. So what I'm going to talk about is really using types to support software development and to help us to get correct software. That's the motivation behind the programming language Idris, is to give us more opportunities to explain what the program is supposed to do, explain the plan, so that the machine can help us actually get the plan right. Okay, so we'll get the important things out of the way first, which is how to install it. So not many of you have brought your laptops, but if you brought your laptops, you could just type this and then play with it, and then it would be fine. But you type this in afterwards and have a play. You can download it from the website. If you have a Mac, it says a binary and so on. There's a tutorial which is actively developed. What I'm going to do is just give you some demonstrations that you can then play with later. Now notice here I say that it's a Pac-Man complete functional programming language. This phrase Pac-Man complete was just introduced to me quite recently. I used to describe Idris as practical, and then I realized that you know, it's not really for me to say if my language is practical. It's for other people to try it and have a go. So I stopped calling it practical. I tried general purpose, but nobody really knew what that meant. Pac-Man complete simply means that I think there's enough here to be able to implement Pac-Man if you really want to. Tells you a lot more than Turing completeness. So Turing completeness just, what are some examples of things that are Turing complete? The Game of Life, C++ templates, Whitespace. And this, you know, none of these things are, you know, things you actually want to program in. Idris, on the other hand, yes, it's Turing complete, or has a Turing complete fragment, but you can actually write software in it if you really want to. Right, so I'm going to talk about why types matter, and I'm going to tell you a bit about programming in Idris. So what are types for? Well, I've given you a little bit of a motivation with the Mars Climate Orbiter. It's for, you know, making sure that we get the program right before we run it. So checking a program has the intended properties, checking it against its given plan, and that everything is working consistently. Also, we see this a bit less, although we're starting to see that a bit more even in Haskell these days, is using the types to guide a programmer towards the correct program. So is there anyone here who doesn't use Haskell fairly regularly, I wonder? That's reassuring for one or two, okay. I was thinking for a Haskell user group, you would probably all at least be able to read Haskell. But I go to Edinburgh Pearlmongers, so I can't really I can't really, you know, make these assumptions. And actually, the most common topic of conversation at Edinburgh Pearlmongers lately seems to have been Haskell, which is a little bit disturbing. But anyway, The reason I ask is that one of the things, the various things you can do to use the type system to help you towards the right program, like if you add a field to a record, what do you do? Do you go through your entire program searching for uses for that record, or do you just hit compile and work your way through the type error messages? Of course, you just work your way through the type error messages because the compiler knows more than the compiler knows what's wrong. So type systems can help guide you towards the correct program if you say what the type is in advance. And also, one example that I'm going to show you towards the end is using the type system to help you get much more expressive and generic libraries as well as correct programs. Now, dependent types. That was in the title, but I haven't told you what they are yet. Dependent types can mean quite a lot of things. I'm using it to mean, in general, that types can be predicated on values. So, for example, you can have a list of length 5 rather than just a list, that sort of thing. And we'll see some more examples of how this works as we go. This simply means that we get the ability to give more precise specifications. So more precisely, we can say what a program is supposed to do, and hopefully we can get more help from the compiler. Now, most of what I'm going to do for the rest of this talk is just hacking. I'm going to write some programs that I prepared earlier and edit. This does mean that you have the ability to shout, "What happens if?" and then get me to do something, which I guess I should welcome that. Leonard has a look on his face that suggests I shouldn't say that. So anyone but Leonard is allowed to say, "What happens if?" And we'll see what happens. I should also warn you, this is a sort of my disclaimer, that it's quite a long journey from Scotland, and I've come down on the train today, and I spent a few hours just hacking on the IDRIS implementation. And I thought, should I just file this away? And I thought, forget it, just put it in. So if I've broken something, then that's exactly as I planned it, and it's no refunds will be given. Right, okay, so I'm going to start with just showing you a few examples just to get you used to the syntax. And if you've seen Haskell syntax, as I'm sure you will have, this should be completely unsurprising to you, just to show you what's going on, roughly. So the sort of hello world data type of dependently typed languages is quite often this natural numbers, because we're going to use this for quite a lot of stuff as we go. So this would work exactly the same way in Haskell. Natural numbers are either 0 or the successor of another natural number. Brilliant. I mean, it's clearly a silly way to represent numbers on a computer, because if you want to represent maxint, you already need more memory than I've got in this thing here. But don't worry. Firstly, we optimize that. Secondly, it's really about structure. So natural numbers have this structure that other data structures also have. So lists have a similar kind of structure where you've got a thing, and then you've got one more thing, and so on. So in fact, here are lists. So polymorphic lists. Notice, by the way, that I've got a single colon for type declarations. So I've swapped the single and double colon. This is partly gratuitous, partly because it's clearly the right thing to do anyway, and because that's how mathematicians write it down. Well, if mathematicians write types down, I don't know.
David Tarrant who did the gratuitous.
Well, that's true. Yes.
You just swapped them back.
I've just put them in the right place again. Yes. What was the third thing? Oh, I can't remember. Oh, yeah, I'm going to be writing down a lot more types than I am writing down. I'm going to be writing down cons. I think David Turner's reasoning was exactly the opposite. He thought he was going to be writing down a lot more cons than types. So there you go. So that's something you have to get used to. And in fact, I'm often switching between programming IDRIS and programming Haskell, and this catches me out all the time. So it's my own fault. But in fact, I'm thinking of implementing a preprocessor for Haskell that just fixes it. So colon is a way of introducing a type, basically. So you can read this as list is a type constructor. It's a function from types to type. So it's a function from the element type to the actual type of the list that we're interested in. And these identifiers, list and nil and cons, so there's double colon, I always pronounce cons. They all live in the same namespace. I can't use list for one of the constructors if I've called the type list. But they all live in the same namespace because types and values are, well, they all live in the same world in a dependently typed language. So what I've done is I've given explicitly the types of each of these constructors. So this NATS in the Haskell style is just a shorthand. Vectors, well, they're polymorphic lists that also happen to have length. So remember, I was talking about the structure, NATs having structure, zero or successor. Well, vectors are lists with length that you can express. Directly say how those structures map one to the other. So nil is a vector of length zero. So explicitly, we've got the zero here. And given a vector of length k and another thing, that gives us a vector of successor of k things. So any questions on that so far? Is that all reasonably unsurprising? You can see what's happening there. I sort of labor this mostly because if you can read this syntax, then everything else will hopefully be reasonably straightforward to read.
Are you using the red and blue coloring in Conor McBride style?
These are indeed Conor colors, yes. So red here is, unfortunately, the syntax highlighting I've got coming up hasn't, we haven't got that far yet. So we don't have Conor colors for everything. It's the idea here is red is the is a data constructor, blue is a type constructor, green is a, we haven't got a green here, but green is a function, and so on. Right, now. Instead of showing you these, I could show you these examples just to show you that these are completed functions, and just to introduce a couple of features that we have. So if you're writing a function over vectors, then the length properties of that function will be captured in the type. So append here, if I've got m a's and I've got n a's, then the result will be m plus n a's. So this plus is just overloaded as a type class. So we have type classes. We've overloaded all the usual operators. In fact, you can see so here. So this function here, vadd, this is pairwise addition of vectors. So if I've got a vector of n a's and another vector of n a's, then that will come out with a vector of n a's. And if I give two vectors of a different length, that will be a type error. So I've expressed this simple property in the function. OK, so let's actually do some, let's do some coding. By law, I have to show you this. The other reason I'm going to show you this is just to prove that you can actually compile and run things. I know this really shouldn't be a thing that you need me to prove, but I'm going to prove it anyway. So there we are. Hello, world. Good. I'm not going to run any programs for a while. I'm just to show you that you can. Now then, let's just do those vector programs. So remember I was talking about types guiding you towards the correct program, and there being a plan, that your type is the plan. It's what you're going to do. Now, as Haskell programmers, you might think, but what about type inference? I like my type inference. I just want to write down the program, and then the computer will tell me what the plan was. Well, I don't know. I know that's how my students do planning, but it's not really how I want to do my programming. So I've written down here the plan for append. And what I'm going to do is follow these instructions I've written down here. So we have an interactive editing mode that works with Vim, also works with Emacs, where we can use the types and use the editor to basically generate the program with a bit of guidance from us, from the type. So backslash G to make a template definition. So I'm on append here. I'll make a template definition of append. Okay, so append X is Y's. Then we've got the right-hand side. So these question mark names, these are valid syntax. These are things we can type check. And in fact, we can ask the machine what the type of this is. So it's given us here what's in scope, what we're trying to get. So we've got a vector of NA's in scope. We've got a vector of MA's in scope. We're giving back a vector of plus NM. Notice that plus is just it's a sort of normalized version of N plus M for natural numbers. So if you're wondering what that is.
I know I'm not allowed to say anything.
But you're going to anyway, go on.
What happens if you try to compile this?
Let's find out. I have no idea. no such variable main not main. What should happen, let's just give it a main. Oh. There are undefined meta variables, which I think is reassuring, because you know, trying to compile an unfinished program is there are actually ways of compiling unfinished programs, but you really have to persuade it, and it makes you feel dirty. Right. Anyway, if we want to write this, well, I think the only reasonable thing to do is inspect X's. So if X's is empty, then we'll return Y's. Yeah. So we'll inspect X's. So if I do backslash C over a variable, it will give me the cases for that variable. So this is now split into the two cases. So if I inspect this type again, we see, I've got a Y's and I've got a Y's of type vect MA. I need a vect MA. So it's pretty obvious what the answer is. It's just going to be Y's. So the machine can tell from what's in scope, what it's looking for, that Y's is fine. Interestingly, it also works here, because I've said a bit more about the program. I've given the machine a little bit more information about the plan. I want a vector of a particular length. And okay, there are various ways I could do this. I mean, I could just make a recursive call directly, but it knows not to do that. So the machine just has a quick search for what it's got available and then comes out with what it believes to be the obvious program. So we can do the same thing with zipwith. So, yeah, sorry, question.
What would happen if you deleted one of those cases? Would that still compile?
Well, this will compile, but what I can do, I can ask, what do I call it, append. I can ask if it's, sorry about the green, I couldn't work out how to make that green darker. So just as append is not total as there are missing cases. So it'll happily compile it, but you might get a runtime error. Undo doesn't persist, irritatingly. So the good news is I don't have to work very hard to do it again. If I say total now, it says yes, it's total. So it actually uses this information about totality for the compiler too, because if it knows that it covers all possible cases, then you can start doing a few tricks to optimize. Now the measurements I've done, those optimizations don't actually help very much, but it's nice to know that you can, isn't it?
Do you get
car
warnings if you don't have total coverage in UK?
You can do, but I can't remember what the compile flag is. I only implemented it, so I can't remember. I never use that. You can do that, yes. So some people actually, some people like to start with the compiler checking that it's total. So you can even say, all right, there's now an error for it not to be complete. So what you can do is have a flag that, you can give a flag that says check everything for totality. And I know what some people like to do when they're developing is have default totality and then just explicitly say, no, actually not this one. I'm still working on this one. I think that's quite important because the unfinished programs, I think, vastly outnumber finished programs. So it's quite a good idea to be able to support unfinished programs somehow. And also, you know, changing programs. You often want to change a program, like add a new constructor to a data type, that sort of thing. Right, so let's do the same for zipwith. So zipwith is just applying a function across a pair of lists that happen to be the same length. So we could do the same thing here. We'll do case analysis on X's. Now if I do case analysis on Y's here, because they have to be the same length, the machine will notice that and it'll only give me the empty list case. The other one won't type check, so there's no point in even giving it. Again, the answer is obvious. And similarly, do the same thing for Y's. And again, yes, the answer is obvious. So, yes?
It's not possible at all to infer the type, I mean, going the way
around? So, there's actually a lot of type inference going on here.
Yeah, sure.
But not the top level, not the top level. So, no, it's not possible. On the other hand, I think it might be possible to have some kind of limited version of it. Maybe you want to stick an underscore for a couple of these and then have the machine figure it out. We haven't implemented that yet because it's not really the primary thing we want to do. But
if you create a vect, you might not want to specify the size in the time because you know what you're doing when you construct it.
Well, maybe. I don't know about you, but I very rarely know what I'm doing when I construct something. I quite like the machine to help me. Yeah, so I mean, clearly that's useful in a lot of cases, in particular in where clauses, because we have where clauses just like Haskell, and we try quite hard to infer the types of things in where clauses. We're not very often successful. I'm sure we could do much better, but it's something you do actually want to often do. Okay, so that's, you know, very basic writing functions and using slightly more expressive types to get the machine to do some work for you, because, you know, we like it when the machine does work for us, particularly when it's something obvious. We don't like, you know, doing, you know, obvious things ourselves. So I'll show you, if there are any more questions on that, any more questions on that one before I move on? Okay. So something that comes up quite a lot just naturally is dealing with proofs. We can now, because we can put values in types, we can start proving things about our programs. We can start expressing properties of our programs and seeing if they happen to be true. For example, at the top here, I'm going to try to prove that 2 plus 2 equals 4. How many pages did Bertrand Russell take to do 1 plus 1 equals 2? Admittedly, he, you know, a lot of what he did in that is actually kind of important for this even working. So anyway, so to prove that 2 plus 2 equals 4, this equal sign really is it's a type constructor. So there is a type, I'm not actually sure what happens if I show you this, if the parser will, I'm not sure you can read that really, can you? I'll read it out for you. So for all A 0 in type, for all B 0 in type, given an A, given a B, that gives us an equality proof. A proposition of equality. Now, we can have two different types on each side of the equals, but the only way they can ever actually be equal is if they really are the same. So there is a constructor. Well, I'll get the machine to show you what it is. So REFL is the one and only proof that something equals something else. So because 2 plus 2 equals 4, what's happened here is the machine has done some computation. It's established that 4 equals 4. And then this proof, REFL, is just a construction of that proof, the 4 equals 4.
But what type are those things?
These things?
Yeah.
These are actually integers because they are. it's a default mechanism. So we have... Because, you know, it's kind of annoying to be explicit about the types. I mean, you have this in Haskell with the defaulting mechanism. The only thing in Idris is that the defaulting mechanism is baked in for numbers, and it's only because of this particularly annoying thing about numeric literals. So I can be more explicit about which one I mean. I can say, oh, this is a natural number, and I've got to give the type on both sides, because you know, the two sides of an equality can be different types. Not for an actual construction of one, but for a proposition of one, they can be different types. So here is the proof that 2 plus 2 equals 4 in world of natural numbers. So does that answer your question?
Yep.
So this I'm glad you asked me that, because this thing here, this function, this the is not syntax, this is just a function. It's an identity function with an explicit type argument that forces it to be a particular type. So how do you use that sort of thing? And again, this does come up in practice, and I'm about to show you a place where it can come up. So say I have a vector of n things, and I actually want it to be a vector of m things, because, you know, that's what I need for whatever reason. So I'll try to write this function update length of n things to m things, and basically I can't, because I have no knowledge that n and m are even compatible. So what I can do is say, right, okay, I'll take a proof that n equals m, and then we'll write the definition. So I have an a, an n, and an m. I have a vector of length m, n, and I have a proof that n equals m. So we know that there is only one way to make one of these proofs, and that is if n and m really are the same thing. So we'll do case analysis on this proof argument, which is just, after all, a perfectly ordinary data type with one constructor, REFL. So do case analysis, and the machine says, aha, it must be REFL, and N and N must be the same thing. That's the only way this can ever be well typed. So now it's okay, I can use X's. So this is how we start to, if we have some equality in the context, we can start rewriting by that equality and prove that one thing equals another thing by some series of rewrites along this sort of form. Yes?
So, in high school, I'm thinking kind of a left to right evaluation order to evaluate the arguments. I couldn't check that n equals n until I see ref is ref. I'm not supposed to be thinking that yet.
No. The way this will compile, I don't know if I dare show you this, because there we are. At runtime, what happens is, this is not really meant for general viewing, but at compile time, you see that you've got a case on the proof, and so we just look at the proof and construct a, pull out, if it's ref, we pull out E. At runtime, what we do is we've got this argument, which is, this E3 argument is our vector, and it just gives it straight back. Because there's no point in looking at the ends. We know from type checking that they're the same, so what's the point in having another look? This is how you are allowed to have two variables the same in a pattern. This is how you have nonlinear patterns, is by proving that it's really what you have.
Can I write that myself, M, and...
Yeah. I mean, can you type that in instead of having the machine do it for you? Well, as far as the machine is concerned, that's what we did.
What if the REFL hadn't been there?
Because it's got a proof, but it's not convinced until it looks at the proof that proof really is an equality proof. It could be any old n equals m. So we can feed in proofs that, prove what happens if I happen to have a proof that 0 equals 1. And you can prove all kinds of exciting things if you have a proof that 0 equals 1. You're just never actually going to have a proof that 0 equals 1. So, lots of questions coming up now. Let's go front to back. Why not?
I can think of other ways to update the length of a vector, such as removing
elements from it. But you could remove elements, but what are you going to do if, in this case, if n is smaller than m?
Add elements by...
I haven't got. What if there's none?
Yeah, I'd like to know.
Well, I can't write it, can I? I can't write that function. It won't work. If you give me an A that is the A you're going to fill in, then you can write it. So.
So is the implicit goal here code that is absolutely totally 100% type-safe?
Yes.
You can't have the Haskell head.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of the time in practice, you don't want that, but the machine will let you have that if you want to go that far, then do. And of course, there might be situations where that is important to you. I just want to finish that point that Malcolm raised, which is that this function of making the vectors the same length. So Sam Lindley and Conor McBride used that in their Hasakism paper, which was at the Haskell workshop last year. And they came up with a wonderful name for this function, which was Procrustes. Procrustes being the legend of, got to fit in the bed. You either chop the legs off or stretch them out until they actually do fit perfectly in the bed. Any more questions? Because, I know this is very basic stuff, but it's also fundamental to everything that we're going to do. So, yeah.
Is there like an undefined value like passing?
No, there isn't actually. We've had some discussion about that on the. We would say, you should stick a meta variable in. Or again, another thing that I don't think I should show you, but I'm going to anyway.
Literally, undefined is in the Haskell undefined, which just happens.
Yeah, you can implement it using this function, believe me, which takes any A and returns any B. Now, obviously, if you have this function in your program, you can't really believe anything about it anymore. Sometimes it's really useful though, if you happen to be proving something about primitive types. Now, I don't feel like enumerating all the possible integers to show that my program is correct for all of those integers, so I'm just going to trust the machine. Now, you can tell with a very quick analysis whether your program relies on this. So there should really be a flag that says, don't allow this. So while we give the possibility of proving everything about your programs, we do give you enough rope to hang yourself with if that's what you really want, because people do actually write real programs that run, and if you want to write real programs that run, sometimes you have to cheat a little bit. So, right, I'll do this This is taking, on the one hand, this is taking longer than I thought it might be, but on the other hand, these are very interesting questions. So let's prove that something is in a list. So here I have a data type which is a predicate on an element in a list. So to construct a value of type LMX X's is to prove that X really is an element of X's. So I'll explain a little bit about this syntax here, this using notation. Every name, every lowercase identifier that you see in one of these type declarations is implicitly a bound variable. Sometimes the machine isn't clever enough to work out what the type is. For example, here, X is of type list A, and there's no A there. And it's, at the moment at least, not prepared to invent a name for that. So this using notation simply means every time you see X's in this block, just assume that it has type list A. Just bind it with the type list A implicitly. So to prove that this thing, this element, is in this list, well, it's either first in the list, so it's here, we've got it, which is of type X is in the list X cons X's. So clearly X is in the list X cons X's, because you can see it. There, that means it's in the tail of the list. So given that we know X is in X's, we also know that X is in Y cons X's. Fine. Now then, most of the time, the data your programs get will come from users, or the internet, or your cat typing on your keyboard. And users aren't noted for giving well-typed input to programs. So you're going to have to check that what the user's given you is something that makes sense. So assuming that you've got a, if you have a program that makes the assumption that something is an element of a list, well, you better check it. And if you want a proof, well, you better actually construct the proof. So this function isLM, it says, given an X of type A and given a list, return maybe a proof that it's in the list. So if, I could be more precise than that. I'm not going to be, because it would take a bit too long, but much easier to do it, just a proof that it is in the list. Now, there's a very similar function in Haskell called LM. The type declaration is quite similar, except that this is a bool, and this thing over here is just eek. So in a moment, we'll see the difference between what I mean by deck eek, rather than We had a discussion on the IRC channel the other day about how to pronounce this deck eek, and nobody agreed. So I pronounced it deck eek anyway. Now, we don't like bools in the world of Idris. Why don't we like bools? Well, if I were to tell you that the answer to the question is yes, doesn't really tell you anything, does it? What was the question? It's kind of like, the answer is 42. The important thing is to know what the question is. Well, this here is yes or no, and this here is the explanation. So it's either no or yes because is where we're heading. So if the thing's in the list, we'll say yes, and we'll give the proof along with it. So let's just follow the same pattern. Something went wrong. Oh, that's because it's ill-typed up here. Let's get rid of that. Right, so we'll do case analysis on X's, and is X in the empty list? No. Is X in Y cons X's? Well, that rather depends on either X equals Y or X is in X's. I could try to automatically do this, and the machine will say, well, I've got a possible answer for you. It's not really much use to us. Let's not do that. So obviously automated proof search, if there happens to be an answer and we haven't given a precise enough type. I mean, that's what's gone wrong here. We haven't given a precise enough type. Now, if you're writing this in Haskell or with Booleans, all you have to do is check whether X equals Y. And if X equals Y, then brilliant, you've got it. And if not, move on. Problem here is if we just check the type of X equals Y, all we know is, well, either true or false, and that's no use to us. And remember from that the update length definition earlier, we used an equality proof to turn N and M into N and N. So what DECEEK does is it gives us that equality proof if the things happen to be equal. I will just demonstrate what happens, and I'll talk through what's gone on. So it was backslash W then, gave me a new construct. And I will check whether X equals Y. Now, what happens with this construct is, with introduces a new expression that we're allowed to pattern match on the result of. So we're allowed to pattern match on the result of decic XY, and things we learn from that pattern match can tell us things about patterns we already have. So in a sense, it's making a new function. In fact, in practice, it's making a new function with an extra argument that pattern matching can tell us more things about. So inspecting one value could tell us things about other values. That's exactly what happened earlier on when we inspected the proof, the equality proof, and saw that it was REFL. It told us something about N and M, namely that they were the same. So with just gives us allows us to provide more information to do that sort of match. So this next line is the new match clause for the with the result of decic XY. So with PAT is the result of running decidable equality on X and Y. So I'll do case analysis on that, and it says either yes or no. It's made an interesting choice of variable names. So it gets variable names just from some hints in the library. So you can, when you define a data type, you can give hints as to what to call variables and patterns. Z just happens to be the next one in the sequence X, Y, Z. F, because intriguingly, this is a function that proves they're not equal. Anyway, so if I pattern match on yes, well, actually, let's show you the right the context. So the context is I have X in type, X of A, Y of A, and Z is a proof that X equals Y. And remember how we use a proof of X equals Y, or N equals M. We pattern match on it, and that tells us things that we already, that things about what we already have. So I'll pattern match on Z, and it says, great, now you're trying to show that X is an element of X cons X's. And we know how to prove that, because we have here. So it's just and then something. Right, so if I add just, then the machine knows I actually believe I have a proof. So I put just and then question mark, it can fill in the proof. So in this case, what I'm going to do is say, well, it's just, and it's going to be, well, I'm going to say just because I want to provide a proof. And the machine says, well, if you're going to provide a proof, it's definitely not the first one. It's going to be later. So now you've got to provide me a proof that it's in the list later on. Well, let's just use do notation because it's easier. Is X in X's, and then good. So, so all familiar with do notation. This is just possibly returning a proof that X is in the list X's. If it is, bind it to P, and then use that to return a new thing. So now we can check whether is 2 in the list 1 to 10. Yes, it's in the second position, just there here. Is 20 in the list 1 to 10? No, it isn't. There you are, I've tested it, so we know it works. Teehee. Right, so what's happened here is just we've at each stage tried to prove whether the element is equal to that position in the list. If it is, we'll take the proof. If it's not, we'll look in the rest of the list. So, yes?
Are you using REFL as a pattern here?
Yeah, it's just an ordinary constructor. So it's an ordinary data type data constructor.
And why are you not interested in F?
Well, I'm not interested in F because if I don't have a proof that it's in the list, well, I've lost. I can't do anything with it.
Isn't F a proof that it's not in the list?
Yeah, so if I wanted to do something a bit cleverer, I would. Yeah, so if I wanted to have a proof that it wasn't in the list, if I wanted this to be complete as well as just sound, then I would change the type to a dec of LMXXs, and then I would have to use this proof to demonstrate that it really isn't here and check if it's in later on. I'm not going to do that because I think I actually need to write another primitive before I can need to write another function if I want to do that. So this is why just maybe for now.
So is yes, no constructor, is it some decidable type?
Yeah, so
it's not like just either it's A or
So that's the type of yes. And that is the type of no. So A implies bottom. So this P is a proof that A implies bottom. This is the empty type. So that's why it comes out as F, by the way, because this is a function type. It's, you know, if you have an A, I can give you a proof of the empty, or I can give you a proof of anything, basically. So now, right then.
I'm interested in, this is really giving you the position in the list in terms of the proof of the.
Yeah. The interesting thing about this, well, actually, I'll let you finish that.
So the question is, can we easily change the code? Okay, so we get a natural number back which tells us the.
So if you erase all the irrelevant information from this data type, so that is, you know, you've got a recursive argument with a recursive LM, and then you've got a ground thing here, you'll notice that the structure of this is suspiciously similar to a natural number. In fact, you clearly already have. Now, the previous implementation of Idris noticed that and said, aha, that's a number. Why don't I just represent that as an integer? And the only reason the current implementation of Idris doesn't do exactly the same thing is that I haven't implemented it yet. So again, this sort of thing is quite common. It is an index into the list. Why don't you just represent it as a number at runtime? So yeah, I mean, that's a good spot. It is a slightly annoying thing about trying to prove things about your programs is that you often find yourself re-implementing things that already exist in the library, which can be a bit of a pain. But there are people working on lessening that pain. We don't really have much along those lines at the minute. But yes, but well spotted. one more. Oh, sorry.
Just a question about notation. So this is LM bit. It's repeated three times, almost identically.
Yeah, but I didn't write that.
I know I didn't write that, but I'm reading it. And I have to carefully see that it says X there on the second line, and that's important. Whereas the other line is like the first one.
I would be open to suggestions for what would be better.
Oh, I was hoping you would.
Oh, well. you can. If you come up with something, let me know. I mean, I don't find this particularly noisy personally, but then I do work with this all the time. So, I mean, it certainly is. The fact that X and X are the same is, yeah. I mean, the important thing is here, this yes REFL. But on the other hand, the fact that these X's turn out the same is kind of crucial. So,
what happens if you change the second X to a Y?
Are we reassured? right. One more thing before I move on, and I am going to move on, is how many people find this annoying that you have to bind a thing to a variable and then pass it through? Now, I guess with Ross Patterson in the audience, I should mention idiom brackets. We have idiom brackets, but I find even that can be a little bit annoying. So what we can do is simply say is LM X X's, but stick a bang in front of it. Now, what does this bang mean? Nope, it doesn't work because I replaced the X with a C. So this bang means lift this out, bind this to a variable, lift it out. So working depth first, left to right, it lifts it out to the before the previous binder. So it's kind of like ML style, not having to do the binding, just do it. Now I think it is theoretically possible to remove even this bang because the machine knows the type it's looking for. So it knows that this function here is in maybe, and it knows the thing we're looking for is not maybe. So surely it should be able to work that out itself. And on the one hand, I want to implement that. On the other hand, it scares me. So I'm not going to.
Surely as a season Haskell program, you should be looking to write it and bind it to just.there, right?
Oh, no.
Because it's only going to
I'm not that kind of Haskell programmer. I'm not the kind of Haskell programmer who takes away, you know, lambda bindings just because I can and makes things as pointless as possible. On the other hand, I do want to. Well, on the other, fair enough. On the other hand, I do want to take away a bit of noise where the noise is. I mean, in this situation, it's not really that important. But there are, you do find this comes up quite a bit when you're working with state, for example. You've got gets and puts all over the place, and there aren't really any naturally obvious ways to write it with idiom brackets or write it with binds chained and so on. So this isn't a particularly common example, because this would be perfectly doable with idiom brackets much more neatly. Yeah, I'm going to do that actually in a second.
In F, I think I had that you could actually put it in your pure syntax where you have effectful code.
Yes, well, this is where it comes up quite a lot. Yeah. Okay, I will move on to F now. I think writing effectful programs. I'm glad you mentioned that. That was the introductory stuff, and it only took about 50 minutes. So. Let's do this one because it's so you'll notice dash p new effects here. This is new stuff. So I hope it works. Working with pure functions is all very well, and we do that a lot, and that's great, and we can prove things about them. But most programs that actually get run tend to have some effect on the outside world somehow, or you know, have some influence on you know what's on the screen. Otherwise, they just make your computer go hot. And if you're a Haskell programmer, you probably think, well, the obvious answer to that is all together now. Yes, thank you. I don't want to say the M word. I haven't said the M word so far in this talk, and I'm going to try to not say the M word again. I don't think I've said the M word, and then Derek's just checking the video to make sure that that's true. I'm going to crack in a minute, and you're all going to point and laugh. What we've developed in Idris is a notation or a language called, a data type called F. F is the type of programs which may have some side effects. And what I'm going to try to do here is I've got a tree data type, a binary tree data type. It's either a leaf or it's a node with a left subtree and a right subtree and then some value in the middle. And I'm going to walk through the tree, depth first, left to right, and label each node in turn. So I'm going to have to carry some state and you know feed it back as I'm traversing the tree. So the way you do that, well, if you're a Haskell programmer, you just say something like this. That would be familiar to you. It's a function that returns taking a tree of with A at the nodes, given some state, return a tree with an int in an A at the nodes. Okay. I'm not going to do that. What I have is an effectful program that supports the effect integer state. Now, as it happens, I was going to type this in, but given that we've been talking for been on for ages already, I'll just cut and paste. So this program looks exactly the same, in fact, as the Haskell program you would have written. It's label the left tree, get the label at this point, increment it, label the right subtree, and then return the node with that label attached to the value.
Can you explain the syntax on the type of label curly
brace? So this is actually a bit of syntactic sugar. The thing in the curly braces is, I mean, the reason for the curly braces is sort of, you know, poor precondition sort of style. And it just means these are the effects that this program will support.
So it's special purpose syntax for the effects.
So I'll show you how it's defined, in fact. So it is defined just like this. So it's a syntax rule that turns it into something else. So we can run this program just like you would if you were running it as a stateful Haskell program. So execute it, compile and run it. You'll see that the tree has been labeled. I've conveniently given the strings as the actual strings we're labeling. So the only thing that's different here is the type. Now, question, what would you do if you had this program in Haskell and you realized that as well as counting, as well as labeling the leaves, as well as labeling the nodes, you also wanted to count the number of leaves as you went? Well, you probably first realized that you were doing a functional programming course at university doing a very trivial example. But, you know, this sort of thing where you have to add a bit more state, it does come up. So what sort of approach might you take? Just any suggestions?
Yeah? A richer state type?
A richer state type. So that would be something like...
two record fields or something like that?
Yeah, so you could... And so you'd use first and second, first and second, to get these out. You probably write some functions, write a data structure with record projections, yeah. That's actually how the Idris compiler itself deals with its internal state. It's got massive state, and then he said the M word, massive state data type. There's no way around it. I'm trying to get you to say.
Write a T.
State T.
Write a T.
Oh, write a T. Yeah, I could use write a T, yeah. What I'm going to do is just add more state, actually. Of course, the problem here is I need to disambiguate them somehow. So in these curly brackets, we've got a list of all the effects that we support. And we can also label the effects that we support. I don't know why I did that. We can also label the effects we support with just some labeling, that this is going to be the leaf count. And this one is going to be the label, and then once we've said that we have labeled states, well, we have to say which one we mean, which we do, like so. That makes sense. Now, what I didn't say earlier is how you actually run these programs. So if you're running an effectful program, you have to actually get it going somehow, get it from effectful world into pure world. So this function run pure just takes the function, the effectful function that you're running, and a list of initial resources to set it up. So this initial resource here is the initial state. So we started to label from one. So given that I've added a new state, I have to add a new resource corresponding to it. So I realize I haven't actually implemented the leaf count bit yet, but there we go. So we initialize the states that we have, and then the rest of the program stays the same. I don't need to worry about sticking lifts in or any other kind of stuff. This will all just get disambiguated by the machine. Good, it's still compiled. Right, I think rather than going into more detail on that, I think I'm going to skip to the final example, because you've all been very patient with me but asked lots of questions. So I'm going to skip the middle bit and move straight to the end bit, because I was just hacking on it a couple of weeks ago and I'm having lots of fun with it and I want to show you. So, right, that's this one. Whoops. Okay, so anyone done any work with session types? Yeah, okay, so I didn't think they'd be massively familiar. So the idea with a session type is that you're writing communicating programs. So you have, say, concurrent programs or programs running over a network. And if you've ever written a concurrent program, you've probably experienced deadlock and not had any idea what was going on. And it's normally because somewhere the programs that you're working with don't agree on the script they're working to. So, one program is trying to send an integer while the other person thinks it, or the other program thinks it's receiving a character, and all sorts of things go wrong. So this is what I have here is a domain-specific language that allows you to describe protocol scripts and then implement them according to participants in the script. So this is a rather contrived example for a sort of simple utility server that you can ask it one of two questions. You can either ask it to reverse a string, or you can ask it to add two integers. So it's a protocol between a client and a server. The client will send the server a command, and we'll bind that to, we'll call that val. And depending what the command was, so if the command was reverse, then the client will send the server a string, and then the server will send the client a string back. And if the command was add, then the client will, send the server two integers, and the server will send the client an integer back. So what's going to happen is I'm going to implement this protocol relative to the client and the server, and the machine's going to shout at me if I get it wrong. Fortunately, I'm not going to write it because I've already written it. So run server here, this function is implementing that protocol relative to the server. So this is running it relative to the server, and it has a client that it knows how to talk to. This is the so given a handle for the client, which is this lowercase client. And this standard IO in brackets means that while I'm at it, I'm also allowed to do console input and output. So what the server's supposed to do, if we look at this protocol up here, what the server's supposed to do is, well, the first thing that happens is the client sends the server a command. So the first thing I better do is receive a command from the client. Now, depending on that command, the server has to do different things. So if the command is reverse, I better get a string and then send back another string. So that's exactly what happens. The client is the same, but it's the other way, around. So we are evaluating this protocol relative to the client, given a handle for the server. So the first thing I can do IO whenever I feel like it, but if I'm working in the protocol, if I'm working to any point of this script, the next thing I better do, I better be the thing that the script tells me to do. So to a bit of rudimentary parsing, it's not actually a particularly good parser this. All it does is, if there's two things, it assumes that they're numbers and it tries to read them as numbers, and if they're not, it just treats them as zero. If it gets anything else, it treats them as a string. So in this first case, it'll send the server a reverse command, and then it'll send a string and get the answer and print it, and so on. So do you get the idea behind what I'm trying to achieve here? This I'm basically trying to give a script and programs that stick to that script. So first thing I'll do is show you that I can compile and run it, because this is, if you go to some dependent types conferences, this is a step that people seem to omit. They sort of assume that it type checks, so I don't actually need to test it. So if I give it two things, and so the server says, yes, I got the command, I'll add them, and I got 42 back, good. Or, I don't know, just give it a string. If I give it a string, it will just reverse the string. And that'll go on forever until I hit stop. Right, so this is all working because of the effects framework that I've just been using for state. Thing is, with effects, not only can you say what effects I have available, but you can also say how the effect that you've just run affects the state that you're working in. So, for example, if you open a file, then what happens to the state? Well, one of two things happens. Either it failed, something went wrong, in which case you haven't got a file, or you succeeded, in which case you have got a file. So this thing is doing the same sort of idea, just on a rather more complex state. So when you calculate the protocol description relative to a client, what it'll do, go through this protocol description, see that client is sending something to the server, so that means, aha, the next thing I have to do is send to the server, and that will appear as the state. The state is, next thing I do must be sent. I guess I could even show you that by commenting out an entire function and looking at the type of foo here. This is going to be quite ugly, so you'll have to squint a bit. There you go. So update stuff. The next thing we have to do is a case analysis. That wasn't a very good choice, was it? Right, if we're in reverse, what's the next thing we have to do? This is going to be a little bit less ugly. So, yeah. Right, so the next thing we have to do, this is a little bit clearer, a little bit, so the next thing we have to do, all you have to do is look at the next thing. The next thing we have to do is receive from the client a string, which means if I, slightly reluctant to show you the error messages, but I'm going to do it anyway. If I try to send, you know, the wrong thing, if I do the wrong thing as part of this script, it says, that wasn't a very good example, never mind. Yeah, let's, oh, here's a good example, right. When we finally run this thing, we start working with a client that doesn't have a server to talk to yet. So we have to, you know, we somehow have to establish a link to a server before we do any actual work. So what we do is spawn a process for the server that gives us an identifier for that process. Then I have to say, right, I now know who the server is. It's him. Run the client. We can do that now because we've set the server. And so if I don't do that, say I forget to set that channel, what does it say? It says, can't solve goal, the server is not in the list of things. So this, you actually read this as it went wrong. But if you squint and look at it a bit closely, you can see that the server that you're trying to talk to is not available. So believe it or not.
Are you there to interpret the error message?
I'm glad you asked me that. because a guy in Copenhagen, David Christiansen, has the fact that he needs to do this is a little bit of an interesting point in itself. He's written a system that allows you to reflect error messages, inspect those error messages, and actually write down what they really mean. So if you're working with an embedded domain-specific language, say, like, you know, as far as I can tell, 90% of Haskell programs these days seem to be embedded domain-specific languages, the error messages suddenly become rotten because they're the messages, they're describing the abstract syntax of the language you're working in rather than the language that the user actually wants to see. So what he's done is he's written a system that allows you to translate the language that the program is written in to something that might make sense to a user. Now, if this message a few hours ago was even worse. It was, you know, two screens long. So this is the thing I implemented on the train earlier today. And this, believe it or not, is an improvement. Anyway, so what's really happened, the point of this is, or the point of showing you this, is to say that all those building blocks that we spent quite a while over at the beginning are all fundamental to getting this kind of program working. So the client and server programs themselves, I claim, are fairly readable if you happen to be, you know, if Haskell is familiar to you or functional programming is familiar to you. Because all we're doing is saying, well, receive, print a few things, do a case analysis, receive, send something back. Now, I claim that that's a reasonably sane way to write a program that is doing some message passing communication. Yeah?
So the program you've written looks very like the type you started with. So did the machine generate this program?
No, I wish it had. The thing is, it can't really do an awful, well, it can't generate the entire program for you because the machine doesn't know when I want to read something from the keyboard or when I want to print something out or what kind of, well, it knows what kind of order I want to do the protocol commands in, but it doesn't know anything about what I want to do in between. Now, I think if we make the... I think if we make the theorem proving engine stronger, it certainly could. The theorem proving engine, at the minute, you will not be surprised to know that I carefully chose those examples to be ones that worked. But, you know, the theorem proving engine could do a little bit more work. Yeah. This one here. Oops. So you. Well, I'm going to have to change this to something else because I don't have the string in scope. But same thing. So we can't solve that. We're sending sending something to the client is not a sublist of, receiving from the client. So we're basically doing the things the wrong way around. So the machine's not happy because it's not sticking to the protocol. Is that what you were after? Yeah? Right, one more thing, and then I'm going to stop. But I'm sure we can carry on discussions later, because I can't get home tonight, so I might as well hang around. So all we're doing here is sending strings and integers. Now, strings and integers are very useful because as humans we understand them. But I told you, and you believed me, and nobody asked me what was going on here, you believed me when I said that this describes a protocol of sending two integers and then sending the sum of those integers back. I could send any old thing back. So what I could do is say, well, actually, I'm going to call this thing X, I'm going to call this thing Y, and what I'm going to send back really is going to be, is going to be some Z such that X plus Y equals Z. So, so I have a type system where I can express this sort of thing, so I might as well. Now, obviously in this case, X plus Y is quite an easy program to write. But imagine that the program you're writing is something fairly complicated, where maybe you know a property of that program, but you don't know exactly how to write it. Well, you could state the properties here, and then as you write the protocol implementation, prove those properties. So what I have to do now is also send, along with the value, I have to send a proof. We'll fill that in later. And when I receive it, I have to receive the proof too. Hopefully that'll type check. This thing is taking a little while to type check. Curiously, not because of the type checker, but because of the parser. The parser needs a little bit of refactoring. So if anyone fancies a little bit of, you know, a hobby exercise and wants to find why the parser is slow in this case, that would be very nice. So here, I have to verify that the thing I'm sending back really is corresponding to the thing in the protocol. Now, in this case, I would hope that the machine is going to find that X plus Y is equal to X plus Y on its own, and yes, it has. So, good. So, as well as describing the structure of protocols and the communication, we can also say how further bits of the protocol depend on things that we've had already and what the relationship is between them. If you are familiar with session types, which only about two of you are, never mind. This is like session types, only more precise about how you write the scripts and what you can do. So my next crazy plan in my copious free time is to add a network implementation of this and do, you know, implement an HTTP server or something like that, just to see if it even works. Right, I better stop there, I suppose, because I've been talking a lot. Right, so finally, quick summary. So why are we interested in dependent types? I think I really mean why am I interested in dependent types? And I'm hoping that as a result of this talk, I've converted some of, you know, I've made that we a bit bigger, I hope, as part of this talk. or at least you're convinced that I should be interested. So safety, we have programs checked against their precise specifications. So we saw a quick example there with the protocol, is that you say what the protocol is going to do, and you make sure that the programs actually do that. We have more expressivity, so we can, this is the middle bit I skipped because of all those questions, but we can give more precise APIs that say how what we do affects how the state changes. So we can give more precise APIs that explain what's going on to the programmer much more easily. We can direct program development just by inspecting types and getting the machine to give us a little bit of help. So giving more precise types gives us a bit more expressivity. I like to put it this way. Sometimes you get a type error from the machine and it's really long and it's like the machine telling you off, slap on the wrist, don't do that again. Well, that's not really what type checkers are for. That's not what type systems are for. They're there to help you. They should be an assistant rather than, you know, your strict teacher. Also, bit of genericity, program generation. So this is almost what's going on with our protocol example. Is we're writing a very generic protocol library that we generate the program based on what the type of the protocol is. So finally, hopefully, we give very precise types to programs so the machine knows more about those programs, so hopefully the machine would generate better code from that. This is something that that I have been trying to work on for a very long time, but real work keeps getting in the way. Hopefully one day we'll be able to explore how very precise types allow the machine to optimize programs really aggressively and get the most efficient code you possibly can out of it. Finally, well, this is an active research topic. We're having lots of fun with it. There's lots of things we're working on. It would be great if some of you came along and joined in, tried a few things, found problems, complained about error messages. So some of the things that we're looking at quite actively at the minute, is dealing with resources, so dealing with data descriptions, making sure the programs, not so much have functional correctness, that they give the right answer, but they behave in the right way with regards to their environment. So I think this is, there's lots of stuff to do. There's lots of fun we're having. It would be great if some of you would like to join in. Thank you very much for your attention. I guess if you have more questions, I could answer them. Yeah.
I was just wondering, for your kind of names and stuff, it's still using the IO on that. But is that at some point going to just become a special case of the
I call them computation contexts, because that's what they are. It doesn't have to be an instance of that type class. So, for example, it could be the function id from type to type. In fact, that's you remember the run pure thing that I had that started states going? That's just running in id. So it just happens that that underneath, yes, we have to have some primitive way of actually running things, and that's the way we do it. So it's really hard not saying that word. Let me go over the top here. Yes. It can't do that. That's not because it's fundamentally impossible, it's just that nobody's implemented that back end yet. So the back end I've written, the reference back end, generates C. It's fairly straightforward, it works reasonably well. Someone has implemented an LLVM back end. There is a JavaScript back end. There's even a Java backend. So those of you who use Java in your day jobs, you could happily interoperate. The only reason there isn't a Haskell backend is that nobody's written it yet. There's also one thing that I have neglected to say so far, and I was waiting for somebody to ask, but nobody did, and this seems a good point to say, is that Haskell is evaluated lazily, and Idris isn't. So this could be awkward, but maybe. No. Well, I guess you find out by trying it. I mean, if you're writing programs knowing that evaluation is lazy, you write them in a different way. I'm sure that you know all about this from. You look like you're wanting to not say something, but I'm going to make you say something.
It's the opposite.
Oh, okay.
You don't have to worry about how you write it.
Oh well, until the memory leaks. I've spent a lot of the last couple of weeks stopping my programs eating all my memory, because what happens inside the readeval print loop is there are internally there is a context representing all the values, all the functions that are defined, and some of them, because Haskell is lazy, it doesn't quite get around to fully evaluating them. But unfortunately, when you add a function to the context, you're extending the context. So what seemed to be happening is that every time I added a function, the previous functions weren't being fully evaluated. They had their own version of the context. So every function was making the context grow. And every time I did one more step in the readeval print loop, the context grew even more. And these things never quite got around to being evaluated. So tracing all the points where that happened Well, it was an exercise in learning how to use GHC's profiler, which I now know far better than I ever did. So, you know, on a small scale, I totally agree with that. Now, you don't have to think about how you write the programs, but if you're not careful, which I admit I wasn't, these problems can creep in. So, anyway, this is the whole strict versus lazy holy war is one that I said I was never going to have again. So I'm not going to say any more about that. Yeah, question at the back. Yeah, why not? That would be an interesting idea. Nobody's done that, but can I somehow generate Haskell code, verify Haskell code that exists by encoding it in Idris? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
So I see no reason why you couldn't try to do that. I mean, you'll probably run into some interesting problems because you have too many Booleans all over the place, say. But you maybe have to start write some of your functions a different way. You may find that some things just don't work at all because of the way you've written them. But it's not a crazy idea. Yeah, I'd be interested to see if anyone tried that.
As you probably know in Haskell, you can make your own classes, instances of monad or monoid or whatever by implementing the append.
Yeah.
But it doesn't actually check the laws. Seems to me like Idris is a great language to fix that. Have you fixed that?
You could do that. I don't have... So one thing is we have an isomorphism class, for example, where you can say there is a... going from A to B and going from B to A and then prove that that really is an isomorphism. So we haven't in general done that simply because when people define new instances of classes, they don't actually want to prove all of these things. They might have some intuitive feeling of why it's right. So what I think might be the right thing to do is have a class and then a verified version of the class that gives you more of the stuff. But I don't know, I mean, that's a design question that's probably worth exploring. But totally, yeah, absolutely, that'd be quite a good use case for this sort of thing, yeah. Any more? There was a question there, I think.
I was going to ask you, I'm interested in learning dependent type theory or dependent type programming. Should I start with Idris or should I start with I? And what's
Can anyone predict what my answer is going to be? I don't actually have a proper unbiased answer for you. It kind of the philosophies of so Idris and Agda they have a lot of similarities, but I think the philosophy behind them is very different. I mean, the Agda people will claim that yes, Agda is a programming language, but really, it's much better at theorem proving, I suppose, than Idris is. But on the other hand, Idris I think is much better at code generation and actually having things that go. So maybe it depends what your interest is. So the interactive editing interface is actually embarrassingly simple to the extent that even if you don't use Emacs or Vim, you could probably implement it if your editor does extensions. It's probably the work of about half an hour if you know what's going on inside, maybe an afternoon if you don't. So yeah, I mean there's an Emacs interface, so that's fine. I would actually say that the real answer is you should try both because you'll learn something different from both of them. As long as you come back to Idris in the end, that's fine.
How close are you to having Idris implemented in this, and are you interested in
that? Not at all close, and yes. So not at all. I mean, it would be a great exercise. It's just that my real job is to teach students and write research papers and that sort of thing, and re-implementing a thing I've just done, it doesn't really directly advance that. I'm quite certain that if we started, we would find out some interesting things, but I think it would hold us up at the moment. But we really should do that. I mean, it's an achievement you have to unlock when you're writing a programming language, isn't it? Is that you actually have to have the compiler written in itself. So I'm very interested in it. It's just not going to be any time soon, unfortunately. Unless someone feels like, as you always say this, unless someone feels like having a go.
No more questions, let's thank everything
else. Okay, thank you.